Jewish Education and Media is pleased to present L'Chaim, a program that highlights the people, issues, and events of importance to the Jewish community. Now here is your host, Rabbi Mark Golub.
I'm Mark Golub. Our sage rabbis teach that the hardest pain a human being can endure is the loss of a child. Any loss of a loved one, a soulmate, spouse, a sibling, a parent, even a grandparent, any close relative or friend is painful and life-changing. But our tradition teaches that death is a part of the natural cycle of life. And it's never about how long a person lives on this earth. It's all about the quality of one's life, how one lived that life, the degree of goodness one has the opportunity to bring in this world to those one loves. But a parent is never meant to bury a child. And when such a horror happens, it's a wonder, it's a miracle of sorts, if that parent is able to go on to live with the pain that never goes away. Tragically, in Israel, there are many parents who have had to lay to rest a cherished, beloved child as a result of the relentless refusal of the Palestinian Arab world to put an end to its war of annihilation against the State of Israel and the Jewish people, and to make peace with the Jewish state. On this edition of L'Chaim, I am honored to be sitting with a most remarkable human being, an extraordinary mother who did not lose one precious son, but two treasured sons. Uriel, her oldest son, and a member of the Golani Brigade, who was killed in an explosion during a military mission in Lebanon in 1998. Uriel was 22 years old. And 12 years later, in 2010, this mother's son, Eliraz, was killed in a Palestinian ambush near the Gaza border. Eliraz was 31 years old, and he was the father of four beautiful young children. Their mother, Miriam Peretz, now tells her heartbreaking, transcended story in a new, most beautiful and moving book entitled Miriam's Song, authored by Smdar Shir, published by Geffen Books. By the way, some of you may know that it is Israeli policy and the policy of the IDF, the Israel Defense Forces, that if a family loses one child, all the other children of that family are exempt from military service. However, after Ariel's death on the battlefield, the other three Peretz sons, Eliraz, Amichai, and Eli Asaf, all became members of the same Golani Brigade with the permission of their parents. Now, I want to give you a sense of what you find in Miriam's song and a feel for this unusual human being, Miriam Peretz. I'm reading from her book. There's no way to speak of the pain of losing a child. All the words of the best writers don't even come close to expressing the power of grief. She writes, I don't picture Uriel at the door because he's in the house. He's here. I live him every single moment, and I die with him every single second. I breathe him, smell him, speak to him and with him. I can't touch him or kiss him. But every morning I ask God to give me the strength to continue living Him. The words of a mother, Miriam Peretz. And Miriam, I am so grateful to have you sitting at this table, and the book is an extraordinary, wonderful, tender, tragic, transcendent, inspiring book. Thank you for doing Miriam's song, and thank you for sitting here with me.
Thank you, Mark.
By the way, we should also mention, in 2005, you also lost your husband,
yes,
Eliezer, so you've lost three beloveds, and there is this, there are wonderful pictures in your book, wonderful. And by the way, I was thinking to myself as I'm reading through the book, in addition to being a chronicle of these horrific events, the loss of a son, but this is, it's not a sad book. No. It's amazing. Am I right?
Yes. You,
it's not a sad book. And there's a lot of family history that explains who these people are. What I find, what I found so wonderful about Miriam's song, mm-hmm, is that you let us learn about who you are, you, all of your children.
Mm-hmm.
You write about your husband, you write about your siblings, your unusual brother, Shalom, whom was called Charlie. So much of you is in this book. It isn't about death, it's about life, and what I feel you are trying to do, and then I want you to speak to this for a moment, what I feel you're trying to do in a book that is about family, the book is about family, is that in some way, Miriam, you're trying to say to us, the reader, and you speak, all, you know, you're here in the States for 5 days, you're speaking almost every moment, and you're speaking to Jewish groups and non-Jewish groups and mixed groups, and before we went on camera, you said to me, you know, it's all about B'nai Adam. We're all human beings.
Yes.
And it's not about whose pain is greater. Mm-hmm. Any mother who loses a child, mm-hmm, any parent who loses a child, mm-hmm, the pain, you don't compare pain. But in the midst of this story of family, it's as if you're trying to say to us, you want us all to continue living.
Yes.
Never to deny the pain. Never. You can't. Don't pretend it didn't happen. Mm-hmm. But find a way. Find a way to go on. That's what I feel Miriam's song is about. Tell me if you think I have it in any way. Do I have it right in any way?
I think that you feel my book, and you know, I begin to cry when you speak before. I know that. I understand that you know everything about my family now. So why I speak today? You know. Yes, this book, I wrote it not for myself. My second son, Eliraz, fallen 2 days before Leil HaSeder.
First night of the Seder, just before Passover.
It's the eve of the Passover. And you know there is a big mitzvah in Passover. A big mitzvah. Vehigadeta lebincha.
You shall tell it to your children.
You shall tell your children about your roots, about your family. And there is no father to tell these four little children. The biggest was 6 years old. The little was 2 months old. What they know about my son Eliraz? Who will tell them about the family?
Your grandchildren.
Yes. So I wrote this book as Vehigadeta Lebincha.
Mazal Tov.
I wrote this book for them to know from where we come and why Eliraz fought and why he died, and why we continue to hold this life.
Mazal Tov, beautiful. I want to ask you a couple of questions that come out of the book.
Yes.
So chapter 10 is entitled, I Knew Ariel Would Die.
Yeah.
And you write this very moving chapter. about how you always foresaw that Uriel was going to die.
Yes.
Talk to me about, first, it's a very unusual thing for a parent to say, and I want to know whether it was frightening to you, this vision you had.
Mm-hmm.
And then one day, and you describe in the book, the early morning when you're awakened by the three IDF soldiers.
Yes, I called them three angels.
You call them three angels?
Yes, why? Because we know about the three angels that come to Abraham to, and they said, you will have a boy, a baby, Yitzhak. And they laugh, Sarah. So she called him Yitzhak. But they come to our family and to many families in Israel, not only family. And when they knocked on our door, they tell us, you lost your child. And they cut our life, the life before and the life after that. That it's not the same. This is another life. I see another thing. I feel another thing. But the feeling, I feel that my son Uriel will die from the day that I have this baby.
Really?
Yes.
Why?
Every time he make me so many problems. He was very ill, and sometimes he didn't breathe. And I asked HaKadosh Baruch Hu, I asked God, something is not good. Why my child can't breathe? And I go with this feeling many years. But Baruch Hashem, I saw him grow and grow. But when he was an officer, I understand that he will be the first in the line. And if something will happen to someone in this group of soldiers, it must be my son. You know, in Israel, we didn't sleep. When you send your son to join to the army, from this day, you only hear the radio. You hear about Lebanon, Jenin, and we live a life of stress because we care about them. What will happen to our children? How I can sleep and knowing that this night my son fought in Lebanon? How can I sleep? This is the feeling of all the mothers, not only mine. And 3 months before my son Uriel fallen in Lebanon, I see pictures. It's no dream. Pictures. I see the funeral of my son. And I wake up and I told my husband Eliezer, you know which picture I saw? And he say, we must do tzedakah. We must give charity. We must do something. We must go to a shul to pray. I go to all the rabbis. I do all my efforts. What I can do? I can pray. I can give charity. I can be good than I was before. But I will never, I can change the plan of the God. I have many plans to my children. I want to see my child Uriel get married. I have many plans for them. But I forgot that the God have many another plans for them. So every day I saw this picture of funeral and I threw them from my mind. I threw them. And I want to see only a good things, but they come. They come to me, these pictures. And on the day that my firstborn Uriel, is the oldest, killed in Lebanon, I was at my school. At that time, I was a principal of school. I was 24 years principal of school. And I feel sadly, sad, very sad. And I didn't understand why I am sad. I can't explain myself from where this sadness come to me. Why? And when I come to my home, something in the environment of my home, something began to prepare me to the death. You know, I tell everybody that the God give us sign, but we can never understand the signs. Only after that. So when I go to sleep, I open the radio, I hear the news, and they say the Hezbollah attacked our basic. Immediately, I think about my son Uriel, and I told myself, this is Uriel. 3 hours after that, three angels knocked on my door. Mm-hmm. And when I opened the window, I tell them, I know, this is Uriel. Even my second son, Eliraz, was in the special unit of Golani, Sayeret Golani, in that this time. I told them I know. They didn't say nothing. I feel, the mothers feel. And when they come into my home, you know, this is the birthday of my son, Uriel. How, God, you do this thing to me. I prepare my home and myself and my soul to the birthday of my son, 22 years old. And all the houses with the balloons, and we write Mazal Tov. And when they come, how they can say this horrible news with these balloons at home? Mm-hmm. So I feel, I know, and I can change the situation.
I asked you, were you frightened when you were so sure he would die? Or did it simply, was it simply something you lived with? And I wonder, after Ariel's death, are you frightened for your other children? What I'm looking for is, in America, you know, look, mm-hmm. American Jews are a world away from this. Mm-hmm. We want to understand, and sometimes there's an arrogance, a lack of humility in American Judaism, American mm-hmm. Jews, who, you know, think they should tell you how you should live and mm-hmm. what Israel should do here. But I'm doing this simply as I'm a parent and you're a parent.
Yes.
That's all. Mm. I don't think I've ever worried for my children the way you've worried mm-hmm. for your children. My children have never been in battle. At times, by the way, every parent worries that their children are going to go out and mm. there's a car accident, who knows. But I want to know whether you lived in fear or not.
Yes.
You did?
Yes.
And where was it?
Very.
Was it in this?
In my heart.
Uh-huh.
But when my Uriel fallen, some soldiers come to me and they tell me, take your son Eliraz, he will not continue to serve in this special unit. He can serve
but
near
not
your
an
house,
active duty. Not an active duty.
So you can ask, you must sign and let Eliraz not to be a fighter.
In battle. Were you tempted to sign that letter?
So, after the Shiva, my son Eliraz said, Mom, please give me 1 week. 1 week I must be with myself. I must go to my Mechina. Mechina, it's before serving after you finish your study in high school. You go to Mechina to prepare yourself. to serve in the army. I want to go to my mechina in Gush Katif.
He meant his group.
Yes. But I want to go to my rabbi. I want to understand which kind of life I want to live. After my brother fallen, which life I want? Did I want to continue to serve in the army? How I want to serve? Which life I want? And I say, okay, my son Eliraz, go. After 1 week, he come and he put the head in my legs.
In your lap.
Yeah, in my leg. And he say, Mom, please bless me. I say, what do you want? To bless you, why? And he said, I decide. I will continue to serve as a combat soldier. And I will be a commander in Golani. And I say, what happened? And what will be with me and your father if something bad will be with you? How we can continue to live? You didn't think about us as a parent? And he said, Mom, which child you want? Child that live, but he died in his life. Because if you didn't give to your dreams to become, if you didn't do your mission, this is not life for me. And I bless him, and we go to sign to be a combat soldier. But when I sign, my hand shocked. You know, I signed for many, many things, for to buy house, to buy car. I sign in many papers. But these papers is the life of my son. How can I sign? And after we do it, I go outside in Jerusalem, in the street. I see the sky. I scream to the God. And I say, don't lehitbalbel, to be confused. Don't confuse. I didn't sign. You sign. You sign. Because I pray to you every time in Rosh Hashanah, in Yom Kippur. You decide who will be ill, who will be die, who will be rich, who will be poor. So please, God, sign my child Eliraz to the life. Please, wrote the name of my son Eliraz in the book of the life. Don't let me to hear another bad news. And I come home and I put in my door, I wrote, here I can hear only a good news. No one can come to my home to say something bad. And from this moment, I understand that it is not in my hand. The life is not in my hand. I do all my efforts to keep my children. I do all my efforts, all the years that my children were with me. I give them all what I can. I told them, don't go to fire. Don't go to a many places that are bad. No. But the life, the life is in my hand. I decide who will die, who will continue to live. No. So from the moment that I give the God, give him, the decide, I feel, you know, very, calm. Very quiet.
Calm.
Yes.
This moment when your son has his head in your lap and says to you, bless me, because I do want to continue. I'm going to be a commander in the Golani Brigade. And it sounds like at that moment you wanted to say to him, don't do it.
Yes.
For the sake of, for my sake and the sake of your Abba.
Yes.
Don't do it.
Yes.
And he gave you an answer that moved you.
Yes.
And you understood he was right.
Yes.
As painful of it as it was. Mm. So you weren't angry at your son for this decision.
No.
How did your husband react?
My husband, it was very difficult for my husband. My husband was a very strong man. But from the death of my son, Uriel, he began to be ill. And I must tell you something, and excuse me about that. The power is in the hand of the women. We know how to have a baby. We know the meaning of the life. We know how it's so difficult to have a baby. And when we heard the first time the voice of this baby, we understand the meaning of the life. And the men are weaker than us.
And by the way, men never experience that.
Yes.
It doesn't mean one is better than the other, but yes. We're different.
Yes.
Sometimes we pretend we're not different. We are different. Because you have an experience, women have an experience men will never have. Yes. And it's, and by the way, it also, there's incredible strength in women. There's wonderful strength in men, too.
Yes.
But there's something very powerful about what you're saying.
Yes.
And you're saying, in some way,
mm-hmm.
you, the mommy,
yes.
the ima,
yes.
was able to deal with this in a way that yes. the Abba could not.
Yes, because I know that if I want to give a life, I must suffer before. You know, I suffered before. But I hear this voice, the first voice in the world when we have a baby. And my husband can accept the death of my son.
Okay.
So it was difficult for him.
Did it create a problem between you and him?
Yes. Yes. But when from the day that we signed, he prayed more and more and asked Hashem, HaKadosh Baruch Hu, please, please. And you know, I think that God loved more my husband than I.
Because?
He took him before.
Because your husband died before your second son died.
Before my second. How he can hear this terrible news at the second time. But I can stand. I can hear the news, and I can continue.
Miriam, how in the world does a mother not only lose one son, and then she's told, and this you did not see coming, as you saw Uriel dying, you did not see the death of your second son coming,
yes.
although again, you sort of knew it was happening.
No.
But what, I cannot imagine the pain and the grief.
Yes.
So you learn that now two sons. What was, when the second son dies, what is it like for you? And are you, you know, I asked you if you were afraid.
Yes.
Are you ever angry?
Yes. Yes. It's not normal to not be angry. I'm a mother. You know, we have a sentence in Hebrew that many rabbis say after someone died, Adonai Natan,
yes.
Adonai Lakach.
Yes.
God give us, God take, Yehi, we bless God.
No what?
I didn't say this sentence.
You didn't say the last part?
Not in the first time. It takes time to say this sentence.
Blessed be the name of the Lord. That you did not say.
No, in that moment. Mm-hmm. I was very angry.
At God.
Why?
At God.
Yes. Why? Why? How you lead this world? Why you take my precious children? You know, I do your mitzvot. I teach them to be good people. They have peot and a big kippah. The environment of my family is, I raise them in your way. Why? Why I? I'm not angel, you know? If I'm angel, I can expect this death. But I'm not an angel, I'm a mother. And mother can't see this thing and say, thanks God. It will take times. And now I love this God and I thanks. But in the first moment, no, I was very angry and they say, why me? Why me that pray every Friday when I light Shabbat candles and I pray Zakeni legadel banim ubne banim. Let me to see my children build their home. Why me? I will never have an answer to this question. No one can give me answer to the question, why me? But what I feel when they come to told me that Eliraz fallen, you know what I feel? I feel that God come to my home and he cut my heart from my body. Because in Uriel, I have only half heart. And in Eliraz, I feel that God come and cut this heart. And I feel that I will never understand what happened here. What happened? And this moment, that it is very, 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 it's a moment that I feel that I am nothing in the world. Nothing. This moment that I feel that I'm without clothes. Nothing.
Naked.
I stand and I think about this God and I get another heart. This God cut this heart and he covered him with goodness, with a good eyes, with a big love, and he gave me another heart to accept also this death. But the moment I only shut the door, shut the windows, I didn't want them to come to my home to deliver the news. I know. When I saw the uniform in the window, I understand they come back. I only stand near the picture of my husband, Eliezer, and I scream to him, what did you do in paradise, in the sky? Why you didn't fight? Why? Why I am here alone? Why? I will never have answer to this question. Mm-hmm. But however, I have an answer to the question, why my children fallen? They have fallen, so today I can sit here and speak with you. Because they didn't fight only for the people in Israel. They fought for all the Jewish people in the world. My son Eliraz told me that every time when he fought in Gaza or Lebanon, he took with him a big bag. And in this bag, he didn't put only bombs. He put all the eyes of the Jewish people. They have fallen so the children in Israel can go today safely to the schools, to the malls. They have fallen because someone must ensure the existence of this land. Mm-hmm. So,
you know, you write about the epitaph, the one-line epitaph that you would write for him. Do you remember what you said?
In the stone?
Yes.
In Mount Herzl?
Yes. Fighter?
Lochem. I will say it. It's not in Mount Herzl.
Where is it?
It is because in Mount Herzl, all the stones must be the same.
Identical, right.
So it's not
that's
there.
That's the National Cemetery.
It's in Mount, we call it Meron. Har Meron.
Yes.
There is a place in the name of my son Uriel.
And they
ask me. Yes. They ask me to write something. And you know, it took for me 2 years to think. I can write only one sentence. What I can write about my son Uriel.
Say so the,
I wrote Lochem, fighter, Sayar,
scout,
Ben Torah,
Torah scholar,
Ben Torah ve'ohev ha'aretz,
and a lover of the land of Israel.
Yes.
Uriel Peretz, fighter, scout, Torah scholar, lover of the land. And then somebody said to you, why do you begin? Why do you begin with fighter?
Yes, because Uriel was my firstborn, and the birth of my son Uriel was very, very difficult for me. And he was very little child. But this little child teach me more than everyone. When I send him to the first class in Kita Aleph, I prepare a big bag to Kita Aleph, and in the bag I put a sidur, but it's not a simple sidur. This is sidur, a prayer book that covered with wood. You know, before many years, when someone give us a gift for bar mitzvah, they give us a prayer book, but with it's covered with wood or something that it can be many, many years with us. And I put in this book also the Bible. So my son Uriel was very little, and this bag is so heavy. And when he come to the bus, he want to go in. But I saw my child try to come into the bus, and he didn't succeed. And I want to help him to come in. You know what? Why he didn't come into the bus? Because the stair of the bus are higher than his legs. So I want to help him, and he tell me a very simple sentence. But this is the sentence that I keep with me every day. Ima, ani yachol. Mam, I can do it.
I can do it.
I know. I have force and strength. I have. I must see these abilities in my body. So Uriel is lochem. Why lochem? Why fighter? Because he go to learn in academic school, military academic school. And when I ask him, why military academic school? We are not fighters. You know, we live in Morocco. I didn't born in Israel. I born in Morocco, in Sahara Desert. My parents are very, very poor family. They never know to read or to write, but they know one word in Hebrew, Jerusalem. And I never imagined that I will pay so much for this Jerusalem. So I ask my child, Uriel, why you go to military school? I don't know nothing about Tzahal. And he said, Mom, I want to be the first chief of staff, the first Moroccan chief of staff of Israel. I want to be Ramatkal Marokai Rishon. And Baruch Hashem, he learned in this school. And after that, he go to the special unit, Sayyad Golani. And he was so little with the legs, you know, like this. He is fighter, not only in the battle, in the life. Very, very strong with a big emunah and want to change the world.
That is wonderful. By the way, there is, again, there are marvelous photographs in this book.
Yes.
But there's a photograph at one point of Uriel. It's Eliraz, Eliezer, your husband.
You remember very, very well.
And there's a very simple caption you write underneath it. They're all gone. But there is, I mean, I get chills even, and it's not my sons, and it's not my father. Yes. But I, you know, it is a gift that's in this book. And again, this picture of the three of them, and they look so happy. And it is an enormous tribute to you as a wife and as a mother. I want to quote something else from your book. You wrote, Uriel's death was a private disaster. When Eliraz fell, our privacy was taken away. And as painful as your own story is, it's not the only story of parents who've had to bury their children by the Israeli people.
Yeah.
And first of all, I know there were times when you wept.
Yes.
Have you ever wept for the pain and loss and sacrifice of other Israeli parents?
Yes.
You have become now something bigger than yourself. You didn't look for it.
I didn't choose that.
You didn't choose it.
I prefer to be in my life.
Yes.
I want to continue to be with my six children. I want to see them grow and build their home. I want to continue to be a principal of school. I didn't choose no one to know me, but this situation.
You have become a national figure now in Israel.
Yes. They call me a celebrity. I'm a simple woman. But I take this situation, and maybe when I decide to continue the life, the people can see this normal, a normal behavior. How you can laugh, how you can dance, how you can continue. And I tell everybody, everyone can continue. Everyone.
Does everyone continue?
Yes. Yeah. No.
No.
No, everyone. But we can. Mm-hmm.
You want them to. You want to help them do
yes.
that.
Yes. So I go to all the families that lost their children and told them, this is very, very deep sorrow. But we can continue the life. We can continue. We must hold this life, which I choose every day to continue. Why? Because I tell you that the God take my heart and he covered him with goodness. I begin to see the little miracles that he did me every day, every day. When I wake up and I can stand in my legs, I say, thank you, God. When I wake up today and drink water, thanks for that. Because I know that there are many people that can do these simple things. I teach myself to see from the darkness the lights. And there are many lights in this world. Mm-hmm. And in every situation in our life, we can see something with lights. We can grow from our tragedies.
Miriam, where do you come from? Where does your soul come from? You know, you write about your own mother and father.
Yes.
And your mother was a very interesting person. Not simple, very complicated.
Yes.
But I'm wondering whether you ever say to yourself, I hope you appreciate, and this is, I don't mean to embarrass you, you have an enormous, you're a unique soul with an enormous strength of heart yourself. Does this in any way come from your parents?
I look at my life and I want to know from where I get my strength. And I think that everyone have, we take with us a big packet from the day that we come to this world. And everything that we do, we have a new tools to cope with many situations. So when I was young, you know, my parents are very, very poor people. I learned in Allianz School in Morocco. And my teacher, when I was 8 years old, she saw a little girl that have nothing at home. And she said, Miriam, I will take you to my home. For what? To clean the house of the teacher. You know, now, as a principal of school, if I heard that the children in Kita Gimel, 8 years, clean the houses, I will ask the psychologi, psychiatr, all the people to say, what to do with this child? But for me, it was a wonderful world. Because when I go, when I went to the house of my teacher, I cleaned the house of my teacher. And when I cleaned the elephant, the statue of elephant, I learned about elephant. No one teach me about elephant. When I saw books, I never saw before books. I learned about books. I never saw bathroom. I never saw frigidaire and oven. We have not this thing. So from the cleaning of the house of my teacher, I know many, many things about the world. And all my life, I think that I saw the good things in every situation. You know, when we come to Israel, we made Aliyah in 1964 to Be'er Sheva. And I live in something that maybe many people did understand, Ma'abara. It's like a camp. We have a toilet outside the house. Think about child that go at the night to the toilets where there is no lights, nothing. So I fight all my life. I cross the valley with it's vadi, we say vadi. It's a big valley with water to come to my school. I take my bags, my books in my hair. I fight all my life. And maybe all this prepare me to the big tragedies that I get. But I'm a redhead. I'm Gingy. HaKadosh Baruch Hu created me with happiness. You know, I hear music, I begin to dance. This is my soul.
I asked you before if you were ever angry, and you were very honest about it. And we talked about anger at God. Are you ever angry at Palestinians or Arabs who took the life of both of your sons?
Never.
Never?
Never.
You know, there are many Americans and American Jews who find that the most difficult thing to believe. Can you explain? Yes. And by the way, I had the honor of being in your presence one other time, although we did not meet. Mm. You were a guest at the FIDF gala,
yeah.
But you brought your son.
Yes.
And I did have the chance to speak to your son.
Yes.
And I asked him the same question. I said, Palestinians took your brothers. Are you angry at them? He looked at me like he couldn't understand the question. Mm-hmm. He said, now I'm asking the mommy,
yes,
the ima, explain to us why I say to you, are you angry at Palestinians? Yes. And your answer is never.
Never. You know, when I live in Morocco, I live, my neighbors are Muslims. And we live together. I feel this is not my country, but I feel I look at them as a people that God created in this world. And I never teach my son to die for our land. I teach them to continue to live for this land. When my son Eliraz, one operation in Gaza, they fight, they saw a little girl, a little Palestinian girl, cross the street. He orders his soldiers, his unit, not to shoot. Why? Because he didn't want this girl to be afraid. We didn't fight against children. They didn't love so much to fight. It's not good to kill people. We want to kill people. It's not normal. But they say, Mom, we protect our people. There is difference between to fight, to kill, then protect our people. If someone come, I didn't hate no one. I didn't teach my children to hate no one. I think we must find the way to live together in this world, because the God created this world, and we must do all our efforts for this world to be good. I didn't want no mother to lose her children. I didn't want, no. Ma, I'm happy that someone died. I know the meaning of the death. I know the sorrow and how I drowning in the sea of sorrow every time. I didn't want this to my enemies, to anyone. So I only love people. And I want God to give them some little pieces of love. And maybe these pieces, we can create a world with light, with goodness, with chesed. We want to live. Mm-hmm. And I choose every day to live. And I hold this life. And I remember that God, when we come to Eretz Israel, God tell us, I give you life and death. Choose life. Choose life. And I tell everybody, choose life. Also, our neighbor in Jordan, in Lebanon, in Egypt, in any place. I didn't hate no one. I have no a place in my heart to hate someone. Mm-hmm. No.
Mm-hmm. Very often you hear that the difference between the Israeli and the Palestinian is the Israeli mother loves their children in a way that is different than Palestinians, because Palestinian mothers are sometimes proud and encourage their children to become suicide bombers. Do you feel that is a fair criticism of Palestinian mothers?
I must tell you that I don't know if all the mothers, Palestinian mothers, feel this. No, I didn't think. I think there are some mothers, we in Hebrew we say, Mekatshe Chaim. We say every time that the life are very, very, you know what is Kadosh? Very, very Kadoshim.
Holy.
Holy. I can't understand the mothers that send their children to die. I can't. For everything, nothing is not good for him to die. Nothing.
So, Miriam, do you think there will be in your lifetime, your children's lifetime, or your grandchildren's lifetime, a different, it's easy to say peace, will there be a way that the Palestinian, and you grew up among Muslims.
Yes.
There is, you know, what we hear is there is a Muslim mentality that believes all of the land mm-hmm. belongs to them.
Yes.
Do you ever think there will be a different mentality that will enable Jew and Palestinian to share the land side by side.
Yes.
Is it possible or not?
It's possible, and it's in our hand. And I want to tell you why I work as as a teacher, as a principal, because I think it's independent in our education. If we teach our children that we can live together in this land, we can live together. I know the meaning of the peace. You know why? Because I live before in Sharm el-Sheikh. You know, Sharm el-Sheikh, it's in Sinai Desert. And we pray every day for this peace. And Baruch Hashem, this peace come. We have peace with Egypt. And the government evacuated my family from Sharm el-Sheikh. It was not easy, but we do this for the peace, because the peace is better than everything. We must continue to have hope. If we will not have this hope, we will die now, today. So I pray every day for this peace. And I think that maybe not in my generation, but maybe with all these youth that I meet, I tell them, this is your responsibility. You, these young people, can change the world. They change the world with WhatsApp, with internet, with many things. They can change this world, and it will be peace, I think. Maybe not in my time, but I will do all my efforts to be peace with my neighbor, with the people that I meet. You know, peace is not only government with government. Peace is to be each other, I and you and our neighbor. It's begin from the family to the community to the country.
Well, I want to talk to you about one more chapter in your book, chapter 26. What a title of a chapter, Dancing with God, Faith in the Shadow of Death. And you write, it wasn't a test of death the One on High gave me. Instead, he put me to a much harder test, the test of life through suffering.
Yes.
Speak to me a moment about that. Your philosophy here.
You know, I told you that I dance with this God every day.
You do, don't you?
I dance
despite
with him.
All the pain,
tango.
You dance every day. Tango.
Yes.
The tango.
You know
why?
Why? Because sometimes he threw me.
Yes.
Sometimes he hugged me.
Yes.
Sometimes I put my hair in the shoulders of this God.
Yes.
But I never let him to go from me. Sometimes I feel that he threw me, that he didn't remember me. But I look after him. I didn't let this God to go.
Bring him back to the dance.
Yes. And we dance every day. Why? Because I have not the answer for why, but I know that the comfort will come to me only from this God. I teach myself to see the hand of this God in everything. When I saw my four grandchildren, I saw them grow. I thank God for that.
How old are they now?
Now 10 years, the biggest, and the little Gilly is 5 years old, and she is 6 years old. And before 1 month, I hear discussing between them. The biggest told Gilly, you didn't know our father. we know our father because I was 6 years old. And she said, why you told me this? I know my father. I remember him with the uniform of Tzahal. You know, this is only the picture that he know about her father. But when I saw them grow, I thanks God for that. You know, in Yom Kippur, it's a very, very difficult day for Jewish people. There is a prayer, Ne'ilah. This is the last prayer in Yom Kippur. And in this moment, you know, all the gates will...
The gates will be closed.
Will be closed.
Your last chance.
Yes, this is the last chance. And all the people, they cover themselves with the talit. It's silent in the shul. And I was with my, one of the children of my son Eliraz, Shir Tzion. She was 3 years old. She looked down, she looked all these people that pray, and it was silent in the shul. And she screamed, Safta, where is my father here? In that moment, I looked at the Aron HaKodesh, and I said, give this little child answer, where is her father? Where? How I can explain? She's only 3 years old. We come back to home. After a half hour, she fall from all the stairs in my house. And she stand. I say, thank you. You give me so quickly your answer. Thank you. You know, sometimes we call our friends when we didn't feel good, when we want to speak with someone, we call them, but the telephone is busy. But every time when I call to HaKadosh Baruch Hu, to the God, he never busy. The door, he opened for me every moment, the door to hear me. So I continue because I understand I can do nothing to change my situation. I can't bring my children or my husband. I go to them, but how I go to them? I go to them proudly. I go to them with smile. I want to meet them. And I want to hear only one thing. I want them to call me for once. Ima. And in this moment, I can die. I miss so much.
Yes.
Ima, I miss so much this voice. So if you have children that call you Ima or Abba, thanks God for that. Because there are mothers that miss so much this world. And when my time will come, I will meet this God and I will give him two gifts. One, I will give this God thorns, T-H-O-R-N-S, thorns, coats. Which thorns? Every time when my son Uriel come from the army, he go to sleep, and I come to the bed of my son and remove all the thorns that entered the body of my son Uriel. I put from the hair, from the legs, from the hand. I put all them in a little box. I never threw them. And I tell my children, when my time will come, take to the grave with me this box with thorns. And for these thorns, my son Uriel wrote a famous sentence in Israel. With all the thorns that entered my body, you can build a flower bed meter by meter long. But this is not ordinary thorns. This is the thorns of Eretz Israel. If you want to live in this country, you must accept many kinds of terms.
Okay. And explain to us, because very often we say, we understand how people love Eretz Yisrael, but the pain that you, for example, have had to endure, and so many other parents, life is not easy. In Eretz, in the Medinat Yisrael, it is not easy to live in the state of Israel.
Yes.
Why do you stay? Why do people stay? Why do you and your friends stay? After your first son's death, you didn't get up and leave.
Yes.
You describe here your Aliyah from Morocco, which is a fascinating and powerful story. Mm-hmm. You've gone from one place to another before, but no matter what, you're staying.
Yes.
Explain, what is it inside you and so many of the people who you know and you love and the Israeli people, how do they stay despite all of the thorns?
I want to tell you, if I will not be in Medinat Israel. So for what my children died? For what? This is my home. This is my home. This is the place that my children are there. This is my home. You know, I meet President Obama in a big dinner that he came to Israel. And I ask him, this is my home. Please do all your efforts to keep me this home. The place that my children are there. So for what they die? For nothing? They die to let me to continue to live in this land. And why this land? Because my grandfather, my grand-grandfather, all of them dream about this Jerusalem, about this land. I feel, only in Eretz Israel, I feel very proudly, even all these tragedies, I feel that I come back to my home. I can't explain how I feel in my home, but this is the world, this is my home. And I hear the new of God that asked Abraham, Lech lecha, go, go. He didn't know where, but he go to this land. This is the land that my grand and grandfather dream about, and Baruch Hashem, I have a zchut to be there. And I wish and I pray that my children and grandchildren can be able to continue to be there, even it is not easy. It is not easy in many, many things. Not in economic, not in many, many things. Not in security, not in many problems. But, you know, like God. You know, we love God when all our dreams become. When we have a miracle in our life. But the test of the faith is when this God take your children, did you continue to love him? This land take my children. Did I continue to love this land? To want to be in this land? Yes. This is the test of my life.
All right, I have only one more word for you. Be'anglit. Meatballs.
Wow.
Tell the story of the meatballs.
Okay. You know, after we bury our children, we want only to be instead them in the grave. I can't eat nothing that they love. When my firstborn Uriel killed in Lebanon, he loved so much cheesecake. 3 years after that, I didn't touch cheesecake. Now I'm a big cheesecake. I love cheesecake and I eat, but it is very it is very difficult to do something, to eat something. How I can eat and enjoy this food and knowing that my son will never eat this food again? So it was one day before Passover that Eliraz fallen, and my daughter-in-law asked me, Shlomit, please, Miriam, can you come to our home? They live in Eli, it's a settlement. You know how much mother loves so much to visit in the houses of our children? No, that is our dream, to see our children in their home. But in the time, it was very difficult for me to come to the house of my son Eliraz, to see the house and knowing that he will never be there, to see the bed of my son Eliraz and understand that he will never sleep in this bed, to see the books that he will never read for them. So when she asked me, it was very difficult for me to come to Eli, but I heard a little voice of my grandchild Or Hadash, and he said, oh, it's good. Safta will cook for us meatballs. You know, every family have a favorite food. For my family is meatballs. To cook meatballs one day after you bury your child? How can I do this thing? So I hear, I ask one of my neighbor to buy for me the meat. I ask her, please, I can't see this meat. I can't. Take this meat to the frigidaire, put some spice. It was Thursday. On Friday at the morning, on 9 o'clock, the taxi wait for me to take me to Eli. On Friday at 4 at the morning, I wake up and I understand that I didn't cook meatballs. I begin to cry. I go outside. I like to speak with God when I see the sky. And I begin to scream and pray, please, God, what I want from you? You take my children, my husband. I only want you to give me now, a little force to make meatballs for my grandchildren. This is difficult for you. What I want? I didn't want money. I didn't want nothing. I put this meat on the table and I go around this meat. I can't touch this meat because I know in the moment that I will touch this meat, I accept the death of my son Eliraz. And I can do it. And I go around and I begin to prepare the meatballs. And every meatballs that I prepare, I spoke with my son Eliraz. You remember my beloved son, when you was 1 year old, I gave you the first meatball in your life. You didn't eat the meatball, you only eat the sauce. When you was 2 years old, you take these meatballs in your hair and in your face. And when you was 32 years old, you eat 20 meatballs in 2 minutes. And now, my beloved son, excuse me, I will continue to cook meatballs and you will never eat them again. I come to Eli, my grandchildren come to me. You think they ask me, Safta, we are very happy to see you? No, they only ask one question. Did you cook for us meatballs? This is bravery. Mothers that wake up in the morning after they bury their children to prepare sandwich to your daughter, to dress, to make rouge. This is bravery. It is not bravery. It to die for our land, it's not bravery. It is easy, but it is difficult to continue to love this country, to continue to live, but life of meaning, of chesed, of givness. This is bravery for me.
Am I allowed to shake your hand?
Yes.
You are out of this world. You are out of this world. You know, I get to meet many wonderful people at this table.
Thank you.
You are as wonderful as all of them. What a thrill it is. I get chills listening to you. You inspire me. I'm sure you've inspired this audience. You know I wish you only now all happiness with your children and your grandchildren.
Amen.
I wish for you peace.
Amen.
And I wish you kol tuva hatzlacha in all the work you're doing for Amcha and the people of Israel and the Jewish people.
Amen.
You have done something extraordinary. I know you never asked to be in this position.
No.
But you've accepted it with a grace and a beauty and a strength. I'm in love with you like crazy.
Thank you.
And I hope that you and I get to see each other very, very often. Thank you for the book.
Thank you.
Thank you for this time.
Thank you.
I am so grateful.
Thank you very, very much. Thank you.
Thank you.
Thank you.
The book is Miriam's Song. Miriam Peretz. She's told us her story. It's written by Samdar Shir. It's published by Geffen. It's available on Amazon. It is a wonderful read, very beautifully written, by the way. But there's so much of not only life in this book, but if you want to understand both the Jewish mentality and the Israeli mentality, Miriam's Song will give you a glimpse and understanding of both. And then, you know, in some way, God puts a neshama in every one of us. And you know,
yes, it's
we will thank God,
yes, for
the neshama he gave to you. It has enriched every human being you've been in touch with, and you've enriched me. Todarabha.
Thank you.
As always, I invite you to be in touch with us with any things you may want to say in response to what you've heard Miriam talk about. Please email me. Write me, post on our Facebook wall, tweet me. I look forward to hearing from any of you, from all of you. Until the next time, I'm Mark Golub. L'chaim, my friends, to life.
Jewish Education in Media.
We would be pleased to send a complimentary DVD of this program to anyone who wishes to support JBS, the Jewish Broadcasting Service, with a tax-deductible gift of $36, double chai, or more, to the nonprofit organization Jewish Education in Media. Simply visit the JBS homepage and click on the Donate button to make a donation by PayPal or your credit card. And please indicate the program for which you would like a DVD. Or you can send your tax-deductible check made out to GEM, Post Office Box 180, Riverdale Station, Bronx, New York, 10471. And again, please remember to indicate which program you would like to receive with our compliments. And we thank you for your kind support.